in September, my brother was talking about joining the service because they were starting up the selective service system. And he said he didn't want to be drafted, so he's going to go down and enlist in the military service. I said, well, I'm going to go with you. We had a pact. We knew that when we were in combat, we had to, both of us had to keep on fighting regardless of what happened to one or the other. And we had a pact that we would forgive the other if we're not stopping to help him because he had to keep on fighting.
In November of 1942, the USS Juno was sunk by a Japanese torpedo during operations near the island of Guadalcanal. Five brothers, the Sullivans, were tragically killed in the accident. As a result of the incident, General Marshall issued an executive order that brothers were not to serve together in intensive combat conditions. But it was not to be so for Walter and Roland Ehlers, who, though placed in different fighting units, both found themselves heading for the beaches of Normandy just in time for D-Day.
Orders came back, they wanted more men on the beach immediately, so we were some excess troops on the headquarters ship, so they loaded us off of that into Higgins boats. We hit the sandbar, and we rush out the front, and we run into water, and it's clear up to here on me, up to my nose. And my second command, he was a short guy, he'd come up under my armpit about, and it was over his head. Well, we waded on in, kind of rushing as fast as we could because there were shells landing out there in the water around us. The chaos was just unbelievable. If you ever saw Saving Private Ryan, I tell the kids, you know, the beach that day was about 60 times worse than what you saw in Private Ryan. We had to cross that beach under crossfire. Just to our right on a hill across the beach was a pillbox, and it could fire clear across the beach. And then down on our left, way down there, was another pillbox, and it could fire across. But there were two in between that were facing straight on from the beach, and they could fire either direction. We got up on the beach, and the beach master there, I asked him, which direction are we supposed to go from here? He says, follow that path there. If you go to the right or left of it, you'll step on mines. It didn't go all the way. It had a row of wire in front of us. And there were two Bangalore torpedo men who were laying in kind of a defilated area. Snipers were firing at them. And we asked them to blow the wire for us. They told us they were pinned down. We said, well, we'll fire in the trenches. So we did. One torpedo man grabbed the torpedo and blew the wire. And as soon as the wire was breached, and we rushed through, but we got up into the trenches and we ran the Germans out of the trenches there. And they started retreating back. And the trenches, by the way, connected up to the pillboxes. And so we got behind the pillbox. We captured it from the rear. I got all 12 of my men off of the beach. And they followed me because none of them had combat before. And they were amazed they got off that beach without a casualty because they saw so many dead men laying around them and injured men and guys laying up along both sides and down, up and down the beach.
Within 3 days of the landing, Ehlers' unit had fought its way inland toward the small French town of Goville.
Night of the 7th, I think we had a patrol who overran the front perimeter of our positions that we had, and command came down that I was supposed to take a patrol and follow them. So we followed them, and we could hear them. And I heard this firing going on the hedgerow, and the hedgerows go along like this, and they're all squares. I'm leading the squad, and I take off up this hedgerow, and I come up on an enemy patrol. Well, they're about from here to the camera from me. With their guns pointed at me, and I just shot them. I shot all four of them. And then I went on up the hedgerow because I heard a machine gun up there firing at our troops that were starting to cross the field again. When I went up there, I came up on the machine gun, but then the guy didn't see me. I just shot them both. When they fired on us, the bullet went across my helmet right up there and spun my helmet on my head just a bit, and I felt the danger. We were drawing fire from three sides. I stood up to fire in a semicircle, and my automatic rifleman came up and he started firing too. When all the squad withdrew, then he and I turned to go back. He immediately got hit in the back, and I was down a ways ahead of him. I saw a machine gun going in position down there, and I was trying to knock it out. Then I got a hit, and it spun me around, And as I come around, I see a German in a hedge row, and I shot him. And then I saw an automatic rifleman laying there, so I got up and picked him up and carried him back, and they were still shooting at me, but they missed me.
Even after being treated at an aid station, Ehlers insisted on returning to the battlefield to lead his squad. But it was not until a month after the Normandy invasion that he would learn fully what had happened that day.
Just before we got relieved off the front line there, my brother was officially listed as killed on D-Day. His company commander came over and he told me that my brother had a direct hit on the ramp in which his whole squad was on when they were coming down. And I knew all of those men in that company, and that they broke me up then. But I just had to turn around and leave, go back to the building that we were staying in there and laid down and cried my head out. We call ourselves recipients, and people call us winners. And you see, we're not winners because we weren't in a competition for trying to win anything. We happen to be recognized by our fellow men, and so we wear this medal to honor them and to honor the guys who really paid the supreme sacrifice, because we are here today because of them. I consider my brother a hero because he paid the supreme sacrifice. And so after it was all over, I came back to my senses, knew what I had to do, and keep on fighting.